Listen, Mendes was so happy with that long take Inspector that he decided to make an entire movie that way, and I'm a sucker for it.
We experience our lives as one long continuous shot. That's how we live, that's how we walk through our life. It's editing that is the gimmick.
I know there's a little bit of a debate on whether long takes bring you into a movie or if they're just too showy for their own good, but like many other techniques, I see it as a cinematic tool that can be used or abused. I usually have respect for it because it's not lazy, you know? It's not like found footage movies that end up becoming a trend because any 12-year-old could shake a camera. It takes a lot of work to choreograph everything to fit one take.
Sometimes you have a camera being carried by an operator, hooked onto a wire, and the wire carries it across more land, and it's unhooked again. That operator runs with it, then steps onto a small Jeep.
This movie reminded me of The Raid 2, one of my favorites, and all the tricks they did with the cameramen, and where they had actually a cameraman dress up like a car seat in order to pass the camera into the car to get the shot during a chase scene. And in 1917, they did have the cameramen dress up as soldiers in order for Mendes to get a shot. We've seen long takes in several films, from movies like Birdman, using it to emphasize the hybrid of stage and film. Goodfellas' one take is a barrage of excess that Karen experiences. The first season of Hill House uses it for scares, kidding to show the passage of time. Victoria and Russian Ark are the first two that always come to my mind when dealing with a film that actually is shot entirely in one take, and it does feel impressive. Even though sometimes you can feel the camera. But 1917 to me felt like the long takes in The Revenant, where the camera is right in the wilderness with them. The perspective that Son of Saw had, except you can see the surroundings. And unlike Star Wars, which took up a month's worth of IMAX theaters, even though it wasn't even shot in the format, this is one I personally give a high IMAX combo price to. Let me explain. So as always, and like the title says, spoilers. Even though it is a pretty simple plot about two soldiers having to deliver a message across enemy lines, but a lot of great movies are point A to point B. But like Dunkirk and They Shall Not Grow Old, all of these veteran filmmakers are getting an opportunity to make movies dedicated to their forefathers who served in the war and told them the stories growing up, including Sam, whose grandpappy was a messenger.
And because he was very small, he was 5.5 feet,
yeah,
and the mist hung at 6 feet in no man's land in the winter. They sent him with messages so he couldn't be seen above the top of the mist by the enemy.
Wow.
And it's interesting to see a war movie where they're actually trying to stop the war. The entire time you're following these guys, the camera's either pulling you or pushing you. It's all choreographed depending on the mood that they're going for that specific setting. Then there'll be times where the camera hasn't cut. The characters have to cross a pond and somehow the camera just starts floating seamlessly while they're being fired at.
The story, because we never stop moving and the camera never cuts, will dictate the length of the set, you know, the size of the set that we're moving through. You know, the set needs to be the length of the scene, and the scene needs to be the length of the set.
Poor guys were standing there through all of the debris and stuff, all the explosions, like the twins from Breaking Bad. And I love how once the set was choreographed to their speed, they better not get slower. One of the interviews they were doing for press, George the actor talked about how drenched and tired and out of breath he was in between takes, and Sam comes up to him and he's like, "Hey, you're never going to be this young again. You're good."
Action would just mean sort of exist.
And, you know, and that's then, a good one, I like that.
You know, and exist.
And stop existing. Yeah.
Of course, the actors were always safe and never put in any danger, as the studio would say. But look, that's real debris right there, man. It sells the shot. And considering the sequences that involved explosions were sometimes limited down to, you know, the four tries they had, because that's all the explosions that they had available, anytime you see this man running and flopping, he's trying to catch up to the camera to not have to do it again. Really?
I think my favorite scene, I think it's just you running and just when you bump, everyone's bumping into you and you're...
Yeah, well that's a mistake that made it in. That wasn't meant to happen.
So that's really him right there trying to catch up to the camera. Like after 6 months of rehearsals and everyone on set not wanting to do any do-overs, there was probably more tension in pivoting the camera just to go inside a room or in the mud more than there is in a NASCAR turn. You put my boy Lubezki to do this movie and during all those water scenes, the dirt, blood, all of the debris, everything, all of that was splashed on the camera lens like a Pollock painting, but Deakins here keeps it clean. I know some people hate it when Lubezki does that, but others may see the camera as being too clean and that misses the toughness 1917 is going for. So I'm curious to hear what people think about that.
What was the longest take? How many
minutes? I think it was about 9 minutes.
9 minutes?
Yeah, something like that. Somebody tripped at about, it was about 7 minutes in, I think, on something, and somebody tripped, and it was like, oh my God, that was so perfect.
It's honestly like the shot in Roma, except feature length. If you've ever seen the movie Columbus, which I see as a masterclass of staging actors, you get a scene where two leads who don't know each other are having a conversation with a barrier of unfamiliarity between them. But the more they talk, the more they get to know each other, the more things open up. You can watch the movie on mute and understand everything through its visual language. 1917 has way more spectacle, but it does the same thing in the trenches, minus the romance. I love how throughout the entire shoot, they just kept waiting for the clouds to move, because if there's one thing Deakins knows, it's light. And considering the camera was pulling 360s, my man had nowhere to set up his lights, so they just relied on the clouds every day. Deakins talking about how he had like 47 weather apps on his phone, because they were always going for the gloominess that the story's tone needed. And then by the end, they were waiting for the sun.
There's a bunker that's lit by, you know, period oil lamps. They're actually real oil lamps from the time. And that's sort of dummied with a little electric bulbs. And the camera comes in and does 360 and moves around the bunker. And every time the camera's moving, those lamps are on dimmers. So one's going up and one's going down. I mean, hopefully nobody notices, but I think it's an interesting thing sort of behind the scenes that it was that complex to do.
Their use of color and lenses feel like war pictures come to life, kind of like Jackson's Dog showcased, and it was really cool seeing that they based a lot of the scenes on photographs of Paul Nash, especially when dealing with the flares. And then there's just a wild ride these guys go on. Schofield, there's a point where he cuts his hand and then it goes into a corpse.
It went through the body with the body had the consistency of camembert. Believe it or not, I took that from a diary that someone wrote in 1919. They were part, because they were still conscripting men to clean up no man's land because of the bodies. And he had another quote, and he was like, as long as bodies were fresh, I found I could reason with them.
He's drowning in the water using bodies as a lifesaver. They're socking and bopping him, getting stuck in the mud like it's Death Stranding. But one thing I really liked was contrasting the new, younger actors who you're following on this journey with familiar cameos. It's kind of like when Matt Damon appears in a movie and he gets to be a cheat code since we all know him. And we know he's lost again, probably. Well, each British actor that they meet feels like a checkpoint. You know, they're familiar, so you feel our two leads are in a safe place until they meet Andrew Scott. One of the biggest complaints I've heard about the movie is that there's not much character in the characters, which is weird because those are the same people who also like Dunkirk.
We find out a huge amount about them, but we just don't spoon-feed it to the audience. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I most liked about this process was Sam and I, and indeed everyone on the film, would be like, the less treat the audience like the smart people they are.
I think the movie gives you enough to piece together who these guys are after 6 months of serving together. We find out Schofield has a wife and child, which makes that midnight sequence even more powerful as they remind him of back home, and it's what keeps him pushing forward at that point in his journey. Blake spends the whole movie, really his life, hoping to get a medal just like his older brother had, and he reminds me a lot of George from Dunkirk, who was eager to serve alongside his peers. So when the one true king of the North comes out at the end as Blake's older brother, and dude refuses to close his grip because he couldn't grasp hearing baby No, that got me! In the end, it finishes right where it started, but again, in a much sunnier place, after a long journey that came with sacrifices and a determination in order to save thousands.
Finally, I'd like to dedicate this to my grandfather, Alfred Hubert Mendes, who inspired this film. He signed up for the First World War, he was age 17, and I hope he's looking down on us, and I fervently hope, it never ever happens again. Thank you very much.
Thank you guys for checking out this video, and I'm curious to know your thoughts down below in the comment section. I think it's a technical achievement. I love this movie. I think it's fantastic. I know that the story may not be for everyone. A lot of people don't feel like, I don't know, it's as investing as a story, but it's just a point A to point B type of movie to get you like in the environment of it. So I enjoyed it for that aspect of it. I would highly recommend watching it in IMAX, but I know it may not be everybody else's cup of tea, but you know, just the way everything, look, just listen to this.
So the camera would have been this big, and the lens would have been that big, but now the camera's that big and the lens is that big, which seems kind of ironic. It's a beautiful piece of design.
It's just crazy to see where we come with technology. Some of the bit of research that I did was Christy Wilson Cairns, I believe is how you pronounce her name. She was the screenwriter for this, or co-screenwriter with Sam Mendes. I was searching some of the stuff. Yo, she is doing Last Night in Soho, you know, the one with Edgar Wright. She's doing The Good Nurse with the director of The Hunt. She is on one. I don't even know. I'm really excited. I don't know how she hopped on this. I was reading some of the behind the scenes stuff and how she used to be a bartender. And in The Last Night in Soho, she actually goes back there for a scene. And I don't know, I just think it's really cool. She's really cool in her interviews. Definitely adds a lot to 1917 with all the extra features and stuff that she, all the extra things that she talks about. So I think that's definitely worth looking up. She's about to have a massive upcoming decade too. So shout out for that as well. But I'm curious to know your thoughts. There being part two and three as pitches may be a thing you may be interested in as well.
Make a series of films in the same 2 hours that this story is told, but just with every character.
1917 part two, starring Mark Strong. Yep. 1917 part three, starring Benedict Cumberbatch. Yep. Well, they're all on there. What they consider life and death missions.
But other than that, definitely let me know your thoughts down below in the comment section. Until next time, don't forget to comment, like, and subscribe. All in one take.